from the mountains. So I get back to the shop. We unload the lumber from we got on Pine Mountain. Some called it Pine Mountain. My home mountain before I was raised. And some called it Cumberland Mountain, some called it the Appalachians. So I just call it Pine Mountain. Oh, hang on. Yeah. Balance it.
Well, it won't damage no other tree. It would have to fall over that way. So I'll take the notch out here. So we have to notch it a little bit to take out a block, kind of a little block there to test it, see if it'll split or not. If it's a little bit locky, a little bit twisting, well, I cannot make chairs out of it, so the notch won't kill a tree. It'll go over that. So it won't hurt the tree at all to take a test to see whether it'll split or not before you cut it. If it splits okay, the block splits okay, well, I'll go ahead and pull the tree down.
It's beautiful.
So it loves to go right away this way, that wind blowing. So you want to be careful.
There's some trees that you can stick an axe in to start cutting it down. It goes to whizzing. Gas comes like something with gas escaping. And you know most of your crying say, please don't kill me, please don't kill me. I don't like to kill a tree, but the Lord made those trees for man's purpose. He caused them to grow, same as he caused a man to grow. He tried to make everything for a man's advantages.
This is Pine Mountain. It's my home country. And it's the Lord's country. When I come here, every time I come here, I feel closer to the Lord. And let's all thank the Lord for this day and hope the Lord will give more days to follow. All of you want to, if you ain't got a Chester rocking chair at your home, you want to watch it or whatever, wherever you're looking at it. Well, pull whatever you got up and sit down and relax and pay a good attention. I'll be enjoying it. I hope so anyway.
Grandpa, I watch him work and help him a little bit. And my uncle would pay me money to help him work. And I always say that Lyndon Foucher's most responsible for me ever turning out to be a shoemaker. They made belay all the time, old foot-powered lay, rumble foot-powered. I never did know them making sure the way I do by hand.
That's my grandpa, my uncle's daddy. He made this power wheel for his old pedal, foot pedal turning lay. The power wheel had a big belt goes around this, up over the chuck. At you turn this, well, it would turn the chuck. When you started out, you start out with your hand, then you keep pedaling. It's like a sewing machine. The old-time sewing machine kind of works just like them.
That's where you
learned. I used to help him. I used to pedal for him when.
Well, before he got big enough to make them. Yeah.
Yeah, I used to pedal it for him when he's making sure.
Yeah.
How come he to learn?
That's where you learn. Yes, sir. He learns quickest as anybody I ever seen. There's lots of fellas can't bottom the chair, you know, much less make one. Just to learn it right quick. I just showed him how to bottom one time.
That's the hardest thing to learn about it, though.
Yeah, it was.
Getting the bark off the pole.
Yeah. Yeah. But he learned that.
That was the hardest thing I've done.
Yeah, he learned that right quick, though. Yeah, it is.
Or six-string banjo. And I made that back in 1970.
Did
you? Yeah.
That's pretty, boy.
I'm just about to lose my hearing.
Well, this and here are mine. Worst. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, we'll get that away.
This eye and this ear here is getting the trouble.
Well, now this eye here.
But my right eye and right ear don't bother me too bad.
Well, my right eye and my left ear. We just thought.
Yeah.
Well, our age.
Yeah. You know how old I am?
No, sir. How old are you?
64.
How are you at?
I'll be 65 next year.
Whatever. Yeah. Be an old man then.
Thank you.
do you do that?
It's hard work, I'm telling you.
Oh, man, bound to be. Boy, them's pretty. Boy, he's got it then. That looks impossible, doing a man to do that with his hand. Boy, that's pretty. I don't see how you make them.
You know who that is?
A nice president, Nick.
Yeah, that's it.
You made him a rocking chair, didn't you?
Yeah,
that it?
That's it.
Boy, you.
Right to the White House, right in the Oval Office.
You've seen a lot since you've been into this.
That's a chair. Same chair.
It's a great big mystery, boy, that you can do that, son. Yeah.
Tell me, this is the oldest part of Cincinnati. Camp Washington is. I don't know how come they call it Camp Washington. So they must have had a army camp here one time that called Camp Washington. I think they are yet, too. They got a German town here somewhere in Cincinnati. I don't know just where it is.
Got me peeping, got me hiding. Peep, hide, hide, peeping any way you want to let me roll. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You got me doing what you want, man, baby, but you won't let me go.
I believe I better make those back slats this way than to go make them this way. On account they are bend better to make them by the grain. Yeah, there's a whole lot of what they call Appalachians. It come out in something other, what is it, a magazine or a basic newspaper. They got a certain dark shades in the map that tells where most of mountain people live, such as Appalachian people, they call them. I've noticed where the most of them live there, that's kind of on the west side, I believe, where the most of the mountain people live there. On the west side of the city. And there's quite a few live here in Camp Washington. A lot of them mines and stations that are in Perry County, they worked out, such as Hartbury and Tribune and all them places in there. I don't know. I've read about some of them that gets homesick and goes back home. I'm pretty well satisfied. Pretty well satisfied. But don't forget, there ain't a day goes by what I don't think about Pine Mountain. Yeah, Lord, yep. I call it Kingdom Come. Back in Kingdom Come.
So now, we've had the hewing done just a few minutes ago, and now this is, I call it shaving. But now some people would call it, I guess, a finishing, a slat. It's the back slat that goes in the back of the chair, like your chair, slats right here. So we all go to shaving. I call this a push and pull job. Push with your foot and pull with your hand. Got an awful lot of water in it. That makes me feel better about bending. It's got plenty of water in it.
For any purpose at all, whatever you're cutting a tree for, whether it's to make a house, or make furniture, or make a fence post, make a fence rail, or just anything you're gonna make, it's in the fall of the year. And if you can't pick the fall of the year for that, always use a old moon, from the full moon down to the last quarter. But on a new moon, it's not good to make furniture out of, and it's not good to make nothing out of. I don't know, it's something to do with the moon some way or another.
You almost feel the water jumping out, hitting in the face.
I can't smell a thing. Didn't seem to have any scent at all.
I've been no wood all my life. And I don't know really what it is. I swear I don't. Never seen nothing like it in all days of my life. Peculiar place where it comes from. And it's peculiar wood. It acted peculiar when it fell. Well, now, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, uncles and aunts, and everybody else, we're going to start on, I call them arm rests for the rocking chair. So some of you call them arms. But so we are going to try to hew them out this evening. And First, I have to spread them out. First, I have to cut them up with a saw. Then I have to spread them out. Then I hew them out. Then dry them a while. Then have to use them on a drawing knife to dress them down, finish. And you can't make them by a pattern. The way I've done it, I've got it in my head to make them. That's the way I have to make them, by my head. Use this end for the front of the arm. This end don't go in the back leg. Now we start hewing the axe. So we got to straighten it up this way first. And now we use this yarn for a pattern on this one here. Hope I can see a mark on that wood. I doubt if I can see it or not. Worst wood I ever worked in my whole entire life. I've been working wood for about close to 50 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see that pretty nice. Yeah. Making stuff by hand, you can't make two pieces just alike save your life. So anything that you ever want to buy, something that's handmade, always look at it very close. And you'll see if it's handmade that there ain't two pieces of that chair just as like your life. If it's made by machinery or something like that, they turn them out exactly the same size.
Now we're going to take you back, post as I call them, of the rocking chair, out of the press. So they ought to be just a-sitting in there. They ought to come out easy. What I ain't no good at. I cannot do a good job for the Carpenter's Square. So I guess you just plainly say I'm old-fashioned or whatever you want to call it. But I say I'm a hand man. I do all my measuring by hand. All my dividing by thumb and finger. And so they tried to change me from an old way of life to a new way back several years ago, and just about burnt me. And I'll not name no names about this thing, but I hope they did make some people change a better life than the old ways of life. But I don't think they'll ever change me. So I'm gonna start getting laying out here. Have to do it sitting down. Now this chair, the woven seat, a rocking chair before the rocker goes on it, is 13 inches high from the floor. So we use it square, eight, four-sided, to lay it off and mortise the holes for the slat. And the boulder for the rounds, it goes in this part down here. Two hands and one thumb, what I call 13 inches. I believe they call themselves Vesti, what do they call it? Them people, you know, come in out in Kentucky from the supposed to be working for the government, trying to change people from old ways of life to new ways of life. Visitor, that was it. I call them Happy Pappies. they come in out from all over the country, all over the United States. As claimed to be volunteers, only the government was paying their way. That's back in Lyndon Johnson's administration. I guess it's, I don't know what. Then they had the war on property, people. I was a whole bunch of them there going. They wanted to handle my chair, and they couldn't figure out that I charged too much for them, and they wanted to try to figure out some way to get them chairs cheaper. And I think they was responsible, some of them was, for getting this machinery. And I wasn't had nothing to do with them for a while, and they kept coming around and wanting to try to help me get the chairs making cheaper. Then afterwards, they all dropped me. After I switched over to machinery, they all dropped me. People won't buy them if they make them with machinery. They got no wires made by machinery. So far, nobody has never even talked about buying it. If you're making a lot of pieces, well, you can go ahead and make the pieces on a fire tube, like you're making them by the dozen, you'd say.
See, you set your equipment for certain types of pieces, and you're making one sure that way, you have to change. It's aggravating. Sure is. It's aggravating. Such as power tubes like that, you've got to have a lot of work to save time on them. The way you're making one sure like I make here, it takes more time to do that than it almost does by make one by hand. I guess that thing made a lot of racket on it. Three minutes and a half, what I got counted on my clock. Took 3 minutes and a half and 5 minutes on that. 2 minutes different. As a good chisel like this, you can get a hole completely clean. But here, it don't clean the hole. You have to run it through two or three times to clean the hole. Come and look down in here. Let's see, under this light right here. Now, you see this hole here where it was cleaned? See, this hole's not getting clean here. I'd rather do it by hand because it cleans out good. Now, these holes here is one that drilled by hand. This one's gonna be a tough hickory. I used to back on Pine Mountain use locust, but after World War II, I didn't live on Pine Mountain no more. When I come back from the Army, I couldn't be satisfied up there at Cumberland River, Pole Fork Cumberland River. And my mom bought her a little place on Lewis's Creek and lived there in a little two-room house on Lewis's branch. And Lewis's Creek, and I couldn't be satisfied. Sure couldn't. I went and tried to get back in the Army, but they rejected me because that I was drawing 30% disability, and they had to come down Hazard to do that. And while I was in Hazard, I got me a job. Went to stay in there. In Hazard, Kentucky. And I lived there in Hazard in an apartment about, oh, a year or two. Then moved out on in the country. Started making chairs. Yep, I started making chairs. I couldn't get the locusts to make the round, so I made them out of hickory and been making them out of hickory ever since. People used to stay with me,
lady, she had some children, and
she'd been married, and her man left with another woman, left her sitting. And I kept them, took them in and kept them. And her aunt come there as a Ruth's aunt, her mother's sister. And she got me off way up on Cars Fork. I forget the name of the place. He stopped to get some gas.
Yeah.
And said, well, why don't you, while we stopped here, go in there and get us something to drink? And I said, okay, I will. I went in there to the filling station to get some drinks. And when I got the drinks and come back out, she's gone. I had to call a cab out of Hyman to get back to the house. And when I got back to the house, the doors was wide open, every one of them. She took all of her kids. And don't know where they are or what happened to them. No, sure don't. No, I never was married to her. She's never had a divorce. Her man didn't get a divorce. She didn't like chair making, though. They left, I believe it was in February. 1968. And I never come to Ohio until 1970, May 1970. So actually they built that new highway through that rent me on Troublesome Creek. Didn't have no traffic hard at all with old coal trucks on that old 15 on Troublesome Creek. And boy, that road when I left there, it was caving in and awful. Them big coal trucks. They was tripping them mountains with about two, three veins of coal down around Ball Creek. Taking down about three veins of coal, I think. Taking out his whole hills off. I think you're gonna build a big airport on that place there some of these days. Wanting to make enough money to live, let alone pay rent. The landlord asked me to move. And I bought a new fence to go around the house, and I let him have what I owed him. I wrote Duke a letter, wrote my nephew down here. And he come up there, two of them, Doc and Duke. Doc said, well, I know where I can get a truck, but I'll be back in about a week to get you. Well, I really thought when I first moved down here that I'd get better business. I lived down there about a year maybe before I got much business. Yeah, that chair I made President Nixon, I really hope my order's out, really hope me booked up ever since. Everything kind of dried up last 2 years. People come in and find out how much back orders I was behind. And I guess most of them decided it's too fertile, too long to wait. Yep, it's too long to wait, I imagine. You take last year, and year before that, I just got one order year before last. And last year, I just got one order. So this year, I still haven't gotten any order. So far.
Pretty sharp.
I raised the prices last May from $389 to $489. I just been cooking once today for the last year or two since my orders all dropped off.
You just can't make a living of making handmade furniture at the prices I get today. It takes 2 months to make one, and I get $489. It costs me almost $150 a month to live here, except in rent. And rent costs me $90. And living expenses. And if I didn't draw a disability, or what you might call it, I call it a veteran's pension. And if I didn't draw that, I just couldn't live here to save my life. I did a while make a little money working for demonstrating out for the stores and around and things like that. And that hope out. One time, I'll tell you, it was back in several years ago, I made a bunch of baskets. And almost about a week before Christmas, I took them to town. You know what people offered me for those baskets? 25 and 50 cents. Took you a whole week to make one. And same thing in Hazard, in Perry County, Kentucky. I took some baskets there one time. And that same thing there. They see that I needed the money, and they thought they were going to get those baskets for some of I made some peck baskets all the way up to bushel baskets. And that's sure I get money for Christmas. And that's what they'd offer me for them, 25 and 50 cents apiece. They see you need it, you're going to have to take it. I was traded a chair many times for the grocers in the grocery store. Yes, sir. Get maybe $1.50 for the chair, $2.50 or something like that. Take it out if I take it in groceries. I've done that many of a time.
Excuse me. Randy.
I better put it up, I'm afraid you might fall. So I'll climb up and put it up
there.
You can trace my family back as far as I can remember, or anybody else can remember them. And you find that you take my grandpa Fouts. He made chairs all of his life since I can remember, and plow stocks and baskets and a little bit of everything like that. And churns, wood barrels, all kinds of stuff like that. And he was on welfare when he died. He was drawing, he called it, I believe they called it the old age pension or something like that. It started up maybe 30, 40 years ago. And when the old man died, he didn't have enough money to put him away. Jordan. You take a chair that I make, it takes 2 months to carve one out, a rocking chair, to carve it right, the way it ought to be carved. Not rush on it. Take your time and make it right. To make a living at it, you're going to have to sell that chair around $900. The way things is today, sure is. The way things is today.
Good tidings we bring to new and old. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Merry Christmas! Yes, sir!
Now start weaving. I say, I'm hoping we'll have a whole gang of chair makers after this film comes out. I'd like to see somebody take it up. But what they really ought to do is to get some kind of program to train people to do that kind of work again. Learn them to make their own furniture, whether they make it for sale or not.
I'd advise them not to take up machine-made stuff, because there's too much in it in the world today. And I would say, advise any young person that wanted to learn it, make it by hand from the stump, to take it from the stump to make a chair that they might be able to make a living at it. Now, anybody that likes to do stuff by their hands, there's no wonderful thing about it, just that you sure got something wonderful to do. Or you make something for yourself, this is the key. It would be something other that you could have rest of your days in your home that you made by your own hand. And you don't, people just don't realize nothing like that. Ain't mighty few old timers left. But I found since I've been living here in Cincinnati and Ohio that people really likes to learn to do this work the way I do it here. And so I'd say anybody out there on the land that would want to learn to do this, they should contact the representatives of somebody that could do something about it, to get a program started or something like that to train people. And I'd say if you couldn't get nothing done, I'd pick me a new representative. I sure would. Somebody that would help you out getting a program started. Somebody's gonna have to learn to make sure. I'm gonna soon lay this old axe and draw a knife down. As long as they people, they got to have chairs. Rocking chairs and all kinds of chairs. So I'd like to see somebody take it up and learn to make a chair. So this is what I call a two-in-one. Almost two chairs in one. Hard as making two chairs. The reason I call it two in one. Been many years since I made one like this. Regular rocking chair, got to, I couldn't sell them. Several years ago when I started making a two in one, it just wasn't hard to look at a regular rocking chair no more. So I had to find something that would sell. And I made a two-in-one. No, it's just a curiosity. I'd call it just a curiosity. A lot of people buy it because it had them four rockers. It doesn't make it any stouter. It doesn't, but only advantage you'd have, if you get one rocker broke, you can steal a rock. If you get one rocker broke, well, you can steal a rock. If you get two rockers broke, you can steal a rock. But I've thought about it for quite a while before I ever undertook one. I'd made the eight-legged dining chair before that. I made them before I ever undertook to make a rocking chair. It's pretty hard to make a new design on a chair. Yep, I drawed out a sketch of before I undertook to make a rocking chair. I got the idea from the eight sides of posts to make the
the eight sides that you can make there and make it complete eight-sided around. The backs would be a complete half bent. And those legs would be eight-sided. I'd like people to see just what kind of a sheriff you could turn out if you set your head to make something of it. Now, there's other different ways to make sheriffs right now. It's still sometimes it comes to my head, and sometimes I don't worry about it, I think about it. But people find that all the time they want to see something different.
Pretty good.
Now, they're gonna put a finish on it, huh?
I hope.
Now we're gonna rub the oil on. Now this oil, I make it myself. I use a lot of different things. I mix it all up and boil it down together. Most of all, I use more linseed seed oil than anything else. But to tell you what all goes in it is a kind of a secret. I got my oil over here where it stay warm. Yep, she's still a little bit hot. You want a smell of it? Get a smell for it? I'd hate to take a snort of that. Ah. It almost knocks you down. You can really see the grain of the wood. When you put that stuff on, it brings it out. That's that red oil. Really shows up. This is the first time I ever finished any wood like this. I never did finish it, this kind of wood. That sweet gum is a kind of a funny wood. Several years ago, when I lived back there, I made some chairs out of sweet gum. And the wood kind of looked reddish looking, just like this wood. Sweet gum. There's a difference in a black gum and a sweet gum. A little bit different. Sweet gum has bigger berries on it, and they're red. And the black gum has smaller berries on it, and they are black. And I didn't know what it was. No, guess there'll never be a chair made like it again, will there? I don't think so. I've never made one exactly like that, no. You can look at the pictures and tell that. I've got quite a few pictures of the two-in-one rocking chair, and I don't believe you'll find one that looks like that. Well, the one thing, the burnt situation. And another thing, the front don't stick out as far. The back don't stick out as far. And another thing, I made the arms higher on kind of sleeping on them. And one more thing, a chair is a lot smaller than a regular chair of I've been making of a two-in-one. A lot smaller. And the arms is a little bit different to what I used to make. It's just a little bit different all the way around. Yeah, you can see the all eat is perfect. That and hit, that and hit, that and hit, and that and hit. It rocks perfect.
That's what I'm glad I made the arm high for. You can use a cushion on the arm. You're right to sleep here.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep, that's a wonderful chair. If I didn't make it. For the feeling, the Appalachian Shop, for the feeling of the Apple Shop movie, Paul Chet, the chairmaker, directed by Herb Smith, Elizabeth Barry, president, Apple Shop. Pine Mountain Wood, made in November and December. But here it is, for the last of January 1978, with our Lord's help. Right at home. So feel right at home.